AfterBuzzers, welcome to Mini Spotlights here on AfterBuzzTV, where we highlight Hollywood's up-and-coming talent. Today, I have in the studio with me Chad Michael Collins, who you may recognize from multiple action roles and also from the hit TV show Once Upon a Time and, of course, the Sniper films. Stay tuned.
I'm Maria Menounos, and you're tuned in to AfterBuzzTV, the ESPN of TV talk. Now, with the buzz...
Our little jingle.
Yeah, I love it.
Catchy, huh?
The ESPN.
ESPN of TV talk shows.
I love that.
That's who we are.
Now you're big ESPN fan.
Yeah. What's up, everybody? I'm your host, Juana Dizon. Thanks for joining us again on Mini Spotlights here on AfterBuzz TV. And sitting next to me is Chad Michael Collins. How you doing?
I'm great. How are you?
Great. Welcome back. I know that you've been in here a while ago, I think for Once Upon a Time after show when we used to do that.
Once Upon a Time, yeah, I had a short-lived sci-fi series called Extinct, and some of the Sniper movies I've done, I've been welcomed here a couple times.
So you're an AfterBuzz TV veteran.
I am a vet.
Well, we're glad to have you back, and I'm excited to talk about the new thing that you have coming out.
What is it?
Well, do you want to tell us, or do you want me to?
Yeah, you go ahead.
Okay.
I'm bashful.
So we have Chad Michael Collins in here to talk about his new role as Alex on the very exciting and anticipated Call of Duty Modern Warfare new video game that's being released. And correct me if I'm wrong, but has it been 8 years, right, since the last Call of Duty was?
Yeah, I mean, Call of Duty is a really big beast.
Right.
And every single year they basically announce a title. But the last Modern Warfare franchise edition was 8 years ago, 2011. Mm. So ours comes out next Friday, the 25th.
Wow. So I can just imagine the excited anticipation of all these Call of Duty fans.
It's been 8 years since they've been able to play through the Modern Warfare, which, to my knowledge, is the most popular of all the Call of Duty games. I think Modern Warfare 3, the one that came out in 2011, sold something like 30, 31 million copies worldwide. So,
wow.
You know, hopefully we shatter that record. We'll see.
Yeah, I hope so too. When you started on this project, were you already a Call of Duty fan? I know you are a little bit of a gamer yourself.
I had played the original back in the day for, my goodness, it was so long ago. I can't remember the console. It might have been PlayStation 2 or something like that. But I've been going back through and playing them. So I've gone through and played Modern Warfare Remastered, and then I'm going through Modern Warfare 2. And I'm just about through that, and then I'm going to boot up, hopefully, all weekend long, Modern Warfare 3 and really immerse myself in it before next weekend I'm playing our game all weekend long.
Do you get an exclusive, like, first access to play the game?
You would think that there are some inherent perks built into being the lead of a video game coming out, but honestly, I'm in the dark about most things. When fans and players get to play through this stuff, they're going to see things for the first time like I am.
Right.
So it's very much an NDA, top secret kind of thing, a need-to-know basis type things, even as an actor. So I'm excited to kind of experience the unfolding right along with the gamer audience.
Yeah, that's so cool. I'm really excited to like get in this conversation with you because in your acting career, you've done so many really awesome, really action-packed roles. And now to translate it over to a video game... And obviously, you're probably using like motion capture and face capture. Can you tell me what that process is like? Because I feel like that's something that not a lot of people ever get to hear about, how it's made.
Yeah, I mean, I've been a lifelong gamer. I mean, going back to the early days of Nintendo, Super Nintendo, all the way up through the many, many consoles and their iterations to PC, I still game all the time. So getting this job was really a bucket list job for me. And I had done some kind of a motion capture, performance capture stuff before on some lesser video games and just a day here, a day there. But this was the first time really diving into the full experience. And we worked on this for a little over a year, filming this game for the story campaign in Modern Warfare. So it's what you see. You know, if you ever seen those old Andy Serkis videos where he's playing Gollum and he's playing like, you know, the apes in Planet of the Apes. The full dots on the head and the weird helmet and the contraption rig with the camera facing back in at you in the spandex suit covered in metallic bulbs. You know, yeah, that was our wardrobe day in and day out for this.
That sounds crazy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's really like it's capturing all the little facial movements and everything.
There's no hiding. You know, you'll see my character, Alex, who's in all the trailers and the promos, and there's a lot of pictures going around. you know, they're not going to airbrush your forehead wrinkles
no.
for stuff oh, like yeah. this. Whatever is you is you, and it is on full display in this game.
Right, because it makes the characters real. And by the way, speaking of the trailer, I was watching the trailer, and it's so crazy because I was really invested in it, and I felt like I was watching a movie trailer. Like they look so real and so lifelike now.
I had heard that a lot when the trailers first started dropping. Blur Studios, Activision, Infinity Ward, the technology, the way that it just exponentially improves every single year is so realistic. People thought it was a movie trailer at first glance. You know, when you're watching it off a phone, it looks that good, that cinematic. And I think that's always the goal for games that are grounded in that realism, is to make a really immersive, kind of interactive, almost movie, you know? But you get to play through it. You get to make the choices and do the things, but, you know, it's kind of like a playable Zero Dark Thirty, a playable Lone Survivor, a playable, you know, American Sniper, one of these huge Warner Brothers or big budget films. We've kind of recreated that, but you get 6 hours of it and you get to go through and control the action as it unfolds.
Yeah, very cool. It's like, I used to read those books where it was like, pick your own ending.
Choose Your Own Adventure.
Yeah, Choose Your Own Adventure books.
Yeah, I had
kinda
tons
like
of those.
That, but way more fun and probably cool.
You have come across a den of vipers, and the world slowly goes back. You're like, go back to page 35. Choose the other one. Choose the other one.
Right. So, what was your training process like for, as far as like all the action scenes and the fighting and the stunts and everything?
Well, the actors that play the main characters in this game, I mean, great, talented television and film actors who made up this. So, of course, we were doing a lot of the tactical stuff and representing our characters, depending on which branch of the military or what their backgrounds were. So we did get to work with some Navy SEALs. They had some guys named Mitch and Steve, who were very high level, now retired Navy SEALs. They were with us. They gave us some time with them before we started shooting. They were on set every day, helping us. And the really cool thing is, my character is Alex. He's CIA Special Activities Division. He's like a spook. He's the guy who there's really no files on him, right? But then you have like a British SAS soldier who is by the book. He's British government military. So, and then you have your militia freedom fighters kind of in the fictional country of Uzbekistan, where the whole kind of battle and adventure unfolds. So everybody has a different style. You know, if you're growing up in a Middle Eastern country occupied by Russians, the weapons you use, the way you're trained as a fighter is going to be different. So the SEALs we worked with taught us that, and how Alex would have his stuff and hold it and move a little bit differently, as opposed to like the British SAS and the famous Captain Price, how he would go about his business. So they were instrumental in getting it right.
Yeah, that's so interesting to think about, because, you know, say the average person that's watching or playing the game wouldn't know the difference or wouldn't think about it, but it's those subtle things that really make the game believable and real and makes you feel like you're there and you're in it.
That's exactly what they're going for. And, you know, having done a lot of the sniper movies for Sony, there's a lot of, you know, current and former servicemen and women who love those movies, who love these games. And the least we can do is try and get it right for them. You know, we're not real soldiers. We're just actors. We're pretending at this thing. They're the real deal. And, you know, you want to honor them in that way and pay the proper respects. Always.
Right. Yeah, of course. So a little bit about your background. I'm interested to know, because I know that you came not traditionally, you know, studying acting, wanting to be an actor. And I know you went to college and you were doing some PR and some writing first when you moved to Hollywood.
Yeah. I still don't know how to act. I just totally winging it.
I mean, but now you're doing all these cool roles where you're, you know, doing action things and you're doing warfare movies. So how did you get into it? Did you have any kind of like stunt training, or were you just like an extremist person that kind of like did all these skills, or like what was kind of the beginning like for you?
My long story short to the acting arena was I never acted a day in my life. I grew up in a small town in upstate New York, you know, football, basketball, baseball, standard American small town diet. Yeah. And, you know, I still play basketball and mess around with a little boxing here and there to this day. I've always liked athletics and being active. I was a journalism major. I got an internship out in LA working for a public relations firm, a guy named Jay Schwartz, who gave me my first job as an intern and then his assistant. And I worked there for 10, 12 years doing, you know, publicity for television
and
film
actors. Wow, I didn't realize you worked there for
that long. So I worked in the industry, and just by, you know, osmosis, I met so many people. I was on sets. I was on studio lots. I was in the green rooms of talk shows. And enough people approached me, and they asked if I would act or considered acting. And I said, never have I ever, but let's give it a shot. Mm-hmm. And I really... there was a physical kind of mental component to acting that I really liken to sports, athletics. You know, there's a mental discipline there. There's obviously a physical discipline there. So it really kind of spoke to me, and I had a lot of fun with it and just slowly transitioned into it. Took classes, of course, but mostly been lucky enough to learn as I did on sets and stuff like that. But in terms of the action movie stuff, I mean, that's really the only reason I got into this racket is to be a pretend G.I. Joe,
right,
and to do this.
Yeah, I've to always live loved out your this. Childhood yeah. dreams, pretty much.
Yeah, I mean, between comic books and G.I. Joes and these sort of things that were huge influences on me growing up, it's the only reason I've ever wanted to act.
Yeah.
You know, watching Band of Brothers and Saving Private Ryan and, you know, watching Spider-Man movies and stuff like this. This is why I'm here. Sci-fi series, growing up with Star Trek The Next Generation and Star Wars movies. So this is why I do what I do. In terms of the stunt stuff, I've just been lucky enough to be able to be part of action films, and I try to keep in decent shape, and I still play sports to this day, so I can kind of pick up the stunt work and the fight choreography when it's needed. And, you know, I grew up in a small town, so I was never any strangers to hunting rifles and stuff like that, so I've right. always been comfortable around weaponry and guns. So
muscle yeah. motor skills and
yeah whatnot. So it's always been kind of a natural extension, I suppose, of who I already was.
Yeah, that's awesome. So for all those little boys out there saying, I want to be G.I. Joe when I grow up, this is your role model right here. You can do it.
You can do it.
You know?
You can do it.
Very, very cool. So I want to talk about some of your other roles and things that you might have coming up. I read a little bit about this action horror Western film.
Yeah, High Moon. That actually was released this summer. This summertime, spring and summer, a digital and a DVD release. It went really well. It was really well received. But
and you have another awesome role in this.
Yeah.
Doing...
it was another bucket list role, playing an undead werewolf hunting gunslinger, kind of Van Helsing character with a whole hat, black duster, all in black, cowboy boots sort of thing.
That sounds awesome. Revolver. So like when you go in for these roles, do you kind of like get into an alter ego or do anything to prepare? You're just like... yeah, I'm going to go in there and I'm going to be this.
You know, Colt was a fun one to play. That's the character's name, Colt. And, you know, he was killed in like the 1850s. So he's kind of stuck in another era. And then he kind of gets brought back through mysterious circumstances to the modern day. And he's kind of picking up where he left off hunting werewolves. But now there's trucks and cars and cell phones. And so it was really fun to play that fish out of water old cowboy who, you know, perhaps he's definitely not a gentle type. He's a bit of a hard charger. So, and that doesn't work in today's world either.
Right.
So it was really, really fun to kind of breathe life into that character. And of course, do all the fight choreography with crossbows and axes and, the shootouts and stuff like that, fighting werewolves. It was really, really cool. It was quite fun.
You know, I went axe throwing this summer at like a little axe throwing place, and it's actually not as difficult as I thought it would be. they were like,
maybe just a natural.
They were just like, step back and just throw it. And I was like, that's it. Just throw it. That's your instruction.
I see a lot of videos going up. It's kind of like the new thing. It's like, come have a beer, throw some axes.
That's exactly what it was. It was like a you can drink here and then throw axes. I'm like, something about that sounds not
safe. I can't believe it's legal.
Like,
but,
can you do this?
You know, it sounds like it would only be legal in like Texas or the South somewhere.
Right.
But
well, this was in Florida. It was Tallahassee. So
well, that makes
a little
sense.
Bit.
But I think there's several that have popped up in LA that I've seen people posting videos from and everything. So
I'll have to check it out.
Everyone's channeling their inner Viking with their ale and their axe tossing.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, very something to be very careful with. But so Call of Duty is coming out next week on the 25th?
Friday, yeah.
Friday? That's exciting. And so we know what you'll be doing next weekend then?
I will be absolutely playing it start to finish. You know, I'm going to get that copy. The copy's already on its way.
Oh, yeah. Phone on silent.
For sure.
Popcorn right here.
Yeah. I want to be taking it in like everyone else is. Because you know there's going to be some of those gamers that just stay up all night long for like the 6 to 8 hours and play through that story campaign as soon as it drops. And I kind of want to be there with them.
Do you do any of the like live streaming while you're playing?
I don't. Maybe I will.
I mean,
for
maybe
this
you
one.
Should. If you're the lead character, that seems like pretty a pretty cool thing.
I'm not the best player. But you know, the story campaign, the single player mode is really forgiving respawns. You know, you drop a grenade on your own foot and like you kind of come back, right? The multiplayer stuff is incredibly unforgiving because you get dropped in a battleground and some 12-year-old kid will just completely wipe you in 5 seconds. So I can stomach the single player stuff and I'm not too bad. I think I could get through it in a good solid 8 hours.
Yeah.
I don't want spoilers because I don't know what's coming either. You know, I'm guessing at what happens in the end, like everyone else.
Yeah. So even though you did all the filming, you still don't really know how it's going to turn out.
Yeah. I mean, you get a sense of where you're going, and sometimes they give you little hints of what might happen and where we leave the story for now. Mm-hmm. But I never got a script. Like I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know how this ends. I have nothing to spoil.
That's going to be really cool to just, you know, take it from in your head when you're actually doing it and seeing the final product and getting to play it. Like that's such a unique experience. So
yeah. And the cool thing is my character, for the audiences out there, my character is Alex. His call sign is Echo 31, which you'll be hearing a lot. Alex is. I don't know if you'll play as him the most. I'm pretty sure you'll be playing as him the most. You get to play as other characters too. But a lot of the stuff that I know that I did film has me kind of interacting with the actors and then going right into a mission as Alex. So people will get to see this sort of, you know, battle from all sides as Alex, the top secret, you know, CIA commando. So I'm really excited for people to get attached to and hopefully love Alex and his big bushy Tom Selleck mustache and, you know, and treat him well, make him a badass.
Yeah. Play them good, right? Well, that's about all the time we have. But before we leave, is there anything else that you're working on coming out soon or things we should be on the lookout for?
Yeah, I mean, Halloween's around the corner, so it's a great time for people to check out High Moon, which is available digital and DVD. And I'm also in the season one finale of Creepshow, which is on AMC Shudder, which is Greg Nicotero from The Walking Dead, is executive producer of that show, which is being highly praised. You know, it's based on the old Stephen King movies from the 80s and launched a million careers, those movies. So I'm excited for people to check that out on AMC Shudder.
Very cool. Well, we'll keep an eye out for all that stuff. I wish you good luck playing your video game. And once again, guys, my name is Julana Dizon, your host here at AfterBuzz. And if people want to keep up with you on online, where can they follow you at?
Yeah, Instagram, Twitter, CollinsChadM, and I'm also on the Facebook.
Awesome.
Find me.
Great. Thank you. Bye, guys.
Our founder, Kevin Undergaro, and me, Maria Menounos, would like to thank you for tuning in to AfterBuzz TV. Remember, we're not just the first, we're the biggest in the world, and we're the only destination for all your favorite TV shows. Whatever you crave, we've got it. So go to AfterBuzzTV.com and check out our lineup. Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.